Okay.
All right, you start the other one then.
Did want to mention one announcement, that is because of the social distancing and all that, we are not having communion today, which we normally do in the first of the month. I am going to put a communion service online. If you'd like to do that later on your own, you're certainly welcome to do that, but we're looking at maybe August for our next in-church communion, so keep that in mind today. I do want to wish everyone a happy Independence Day weekend. We had our Independence Day celebration, a little different than previous years. Yesterday, no parades, no public fireworks. Well, there were a few places, but not too many. My neighborhood made up for it with private fireworks, which went on for quite a while last night. But we're certainly thankful for that celebration. So I invite all of you who are able to please rise for our opening hymn, America the Beautiful.
Thank you.
stillness of the morning, in the calm of the night, in the hush and the pulse of all that surrounds us, we call on you, O God. And so we take this moment to pause and to praise you, leaning back into your open arms, inclining our ears to hear your voice as it moves among us, opening our eyes to behold your grace in every surrounding face. Please join me in our prayer of confession. Friends in Christ, I invite you to conjure your image of Jesus. Can you see him? Good people, you and I were created by that, by and in that very same image. We were created to follow that example, to be humble, to offer healing, to give abundantly, to care, to notice, to pay attention to the need that surrounds us. In the stillness of this hour, God invites us to consider the ways in which we do and do not follow Jesus' example. Friends in Christ, there is good news for us to hear. News so good that we should rise and hear it. God, the God made known to us in Jesus Christ, the God to whom the psalmists sing, the God whom generations praise and in whom the Spirit dwells, is a good God, a gentle God, who is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. God sees it all, and God loves us anyway. God knows it all, and God forgives us anyway. First scripture lesson this morning is from Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face shine upon us, that your way may be known upon the earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon the earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, has blessed us. May God continue to bless us. Let all the ends of the earth revere him. This is the ancient story of God's people. In our epistle lesson from Romans chapter 7, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold into slavery under sin. I do not understand my own actions. For I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing that I hate. Now if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good that I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer that I do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law, that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self. But I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God for our Lord Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord. In our gospel lesson from Matthew But to what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to one another. We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they said, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent, and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. You will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the good news. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, may the words of my message be pleasing to you and reflect your will in our lives. Amen. You may have celebrated Independence Day a little differently yesterday. We didn't have parades. We didn't have public fireworks. We didn't have the big picnics that some places have. You may have been home or with just a small group of your family. You may have chosen some other activity for the day. But sometimes we need to go through something like that to recognize the joy that we have. Maybe next year we'll have better shows, better fireworks, better longer parades. More people will be excited, and more people will understand and respect the Independence Day that we celebrate. I want to share with you a history lesson. I know I've shared this with you before because it's one of my favorite stories to tell about American history. On June 7, 1776, a Virginian named Richard Henry Lee stood up to address the Second Continental Congress. The room was quiet because most of the men assembled knew that Lee had been commanded to bring up the question of independence for the American colonies. This was a very important moment, and I'm sure there were men in the room who saw this coming with dread, fearing what was next. And I'm sure there were others that were brimming with great excitement as to what was about to happen. He went on to read this statement: "Resolved, that these United Colonies are, and of right ought to be, free and independent states." It took almost a month until July the 2nd, when the delegates of every colony voted for American independence. They didn't have Zoom and email and all that back then, so everything had to be done the old-fashioned way. But every one of them voted for American independence. Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, and John Adams were given the task of drafting the document declaring the Congress's intention. As every American should remember from grade school, 2 days later, on July 4th, 1776, John Hancock, president of the Continental Congress, along with the other delegates, signed the completed Declaration of Independence and made it official. And that's why we blow stuff up on July the 4th and have great picnics and celebrate, because it was a momentous day, a momentous action. But what was that? What was that declaration? It was merely a piece of paper. It would take a lot more to make it a reality. It would take a lot of sacrifice to make that document worth anything that we would remember some 244 years later. This Friday, we celebrated the anniversary of that event. We went to picnics, we ate hamburgers, hot dogs, we did stuff. Well, we didn't do stuff this year. When I started writing this, I was expecting that we would have July 4th. After all, back in March, I thought by this time everything would be back to normal. But it wasn't. We make a big deal out of celebrating our nation's freedom, even more, I think, because of recent events. The 4th is a day to reflect on history and the sacrifices and the bravery of all Americans. As I was writing, I realized that we have another anniversary of freedom to commemorate, one that's more important, one that affects every living creature in this world, and most certainly every human being, and that is our freedom from evil and sin. Patriots and prophets like Moses and Isaiah proclaim the coming of victory and freedom from the powers of evil. And I kind of hesitated to use political speech to describe this historic religious and spiritual event. But I think it's a language that we understand. We know what it means when we talk about our freedom, our independence, when we talk about political things. But do we understand the freedom that we've received from God in our spiritual lives? Every Sunday is an Independence Day for Christians. It's a day of victory. Almost 2,000 years ago, a man surrendered his life to form a new nation. The nation was not a country, not an ethnic group, not a race. This nation would be bound together by blood and by faith. This nation would know no boundaries on the face of the earth. It would have citizens in all countries, all parts of the globe. These people would speak all languages, celebrate the greatest variety of histories and customs. This nation would be very diverse, yet unified together under God at a common supper table. We forget how powerful that is, how bound together we are. We spend a lot of time celebrating our differences, and indeed we have a lot of differences. Even among just the people in our room right now, we have differences. But we should celebrate, at least every Sunday, celebrate what we share, and that is God's love and God's presence. The founding father of this new nation was Christ himself, and the nation is the church. All of us, bound together no matter where we are in the world. We are a nation undivided and indivisible. Washington, Jefferson, and Adams fought to free us from the tyranny of King George. Christ died to free us from the tyranny of sin and evil. Unfortunately, as the years pass, we tend to take for granted what others have sacrificed to give us. We tend to forget as time marches on. If the events of September 11, 2001 had not occurred, would we see as many flags on our homes? Would we pause during our celebrations to think as much about our freedom? That time is getting further and further away, and now we have a generation of young people who were born after that event. It's up to us to share that. I have a question. How many of you grew up in school and in church everywhere else learning the patriotic hymns that we sing today? How many of you need to see the words? You probably don't need to see the words on the screen to sing at least the first verse. Maybe not everybody knows the eighth verse in My Country 'Tis of Thee, but you know the first one. How about you, Jimmy? I don't want to pick on you. You know, did you learn those in school? Probably. I bet you hear it more often in church than you do in anywhere else, because we still celebrate, and we have to share. Otherwise, that history is forgotten. We forget what it's all about. Right now in our country, there's an argument over how to preserve history. What do we do with that history, good and bad? My opinion is we need to preserve it so we don't forget, so we learn from it. Our nation was founded on the idea that we learn as we go. And certainly the church is the same. The church has changed tremendously since it was founded. And I think mostly for the better. Because as time goes forward, we learn, we gain more wisdom, we open ourselves in different ways to the Holy Spirit. And that enables God to do new work within us. Do we understand that God has watched his Son make the ultimate sacrifice to be murdered, to give us a final chance at redemption? It seems that too often we have to see those freedoms slipping away before we embrace them tightly. We allow sin and suffering to crush us before we run back to God's protection and grace. I want to ask you, now it doesn't apply to everybody, but how many of you have taken a drive somewhere, you have a destination in mind, but you got lost? Somewhere along the way you got lost. I will admit it. You don't have to admit it, but I have gotten lost. And I'm a stubborn person when I'm lost. I think to myself, I'm going to find my way. I'm just going to keep driving until I see something I know. Because that's how my dad would drive. He had a built-in compass in his head. And he would just keep going. Now, I didn't learn until years later that that's not really what it was. It was trial and error. He would just keep driving. And eventually, he'd find his way. He'd see a street sign or something he'd recognize. So I kind of learned to do that. But how lost do we have to be before we stop? Probably every one of us in the room has a GPS in our phone, or maybe one in the car. How often do you get lost before you turn it on? You think to yourself, I know where that is, I'm just going to go. And then we get lost, and then you think, okay, should I get the GPS out? Well, I got to pull over and set it up. Now, just keep going. How lost do we have to be before we stop and ask for directions? How lost from God do we have to be before we stop and say we need help? Not many of us want to admit that there are times when we don't want help. We refuse it. When's the last time you needed help but you just didn't ask? Because you were too proud, too embarrassed, whatever it was, you just, I don't want to say anything. I don't want to bring my problems to somebody else. But God asks us to bring our problems before him, our weaknesses laid out in front of him, because he already knows what they are. We don't need to be embarrassed to go to God. We don't need to be lost in order for God to find us. We just have to recognize that we need his help. the Apostle Paul remind us of our apathy toward forgiveness. He reminds us that we may want to do good, but when push comes to shove, we more often choose to disobey. He wrote, "The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." How many of us have used that excuse? How many of us have done that? How many of us have been that stubborn? I can remember when my children were really, really little, you would tell them, no, don't touch that, don't do that, whatever it was. And I can remember very clearly both of my sons looking at me with this little twinkle in their eyes and doing exactly what I told them not to do right in front of me. Just a challenge to my authority. Just because I said no. How many of you know someone that if you told them to breathe, they would hold their breath? If you told them not to run, they would run as fast as they could. If you told them not to do something, they would do it no matter what it was, just to spite you. How many of us know somebody like that? Somebody rebellious and stubborn like that? Maybe we've all been down that road ourselves, too. I know there have been times when I've rejected authority, and I've done the opposite, just to prove that I could. I don't need you telling me what to do, kind of thing. That's how we are with God as well. Paul writes to us that our minds and our spirits know what is good, but the rest of us can't follow along. But God has freed us from that. Our independence gives us freedom to make the right choices. It also gives us the responsibility to make those choices and to live with them when we do make a mistake. And that's something else that we struggle with. Everybody likes the freedom to do what we want to do, but we'd often reject the responsibility that comes with those choices. And we certainly don't like any punishment or repercussions that happen because of what we do, especially when it's wrong. We don't want to be held back by rules and regulations. But that's not the freedom that God is about. God's freedom is for us to be free from sin, so that we can make the right choices. We still won't always choose to do the right thing because we still have that rebellious streak. But now it's completely on us. We can't blame anything else. We can't blame our nature anymore because God has freed us from it. We're afraid to lose what we now have. We're afraid that our history and tradition will somehow be forgotten. And we are fearful of being labeled maybe too religious or holy rollers to express our faith too strongly, too quickly, too easily. We don't want to draw that kind of attention to ourselves. God tells us to obey and serve, and He'll take care of the big picture. For us, this means focusing on the shared freedom Christ offers with folks around us. And that's sometimes difficult for us to do. After July the 4th, 1776, America was not free. That document was a piece of paper, and it did nothing to the British. King George didn't care one bit. It didn't make any difference to him. It didn't make any difference to the British Army, what we wrote on a piece of paper. No, 5 more years of war would follow. Blood and tears and sacrifice is what would follow. On October the 14th, 1781, General Cornwallis of the British Army surrendered to General Washington at Yorktown. I've often wondered when I think of these dates, why October 14th isn't celebrated as our Independence Day. Because that's the day that it really became a reality. That's the day that we won, that we were separated officially and completely. I still like celebrating the 4th of July because it's nicer on the 4th of July than it is on October. But still, why do we forget? Sometimes we realize that we make our declarations before God and others and think that's the end of it. That's only the beginning. This should remind us that final victories often follow years behind our intent to win. Our church and the whole Christian church are in a long campaign to win a war whose outcome is already known. We already know God's going to win, but we still have to get there. We still have to take the time. We have to take the long way around. God has handed us victory over sin and evil. We have to continue the day-to-day struggle. Even our small congregations can bring great joy into people's lives, even when we're not physically together, even when we're meeting via internet. We can still make a difference people's lives. We have stories to tell and faith to share, whether we are 10 or 10,000 strong. God has a plan for us. We just have to listen. It seems easier to see the purpose and destiny of our nation than to understand the plan that God has for the church. God doesn't expect us to understand his complete will. He doesn't expect us to understand everything that he wants the church to do. He just wants us to do our part, our small piece of it. And he handles the big picture. Jesus promised to lighten our burden, to set us free if we follow him. And he has done that. If we follow our faith and serve him, we can continue to celebrate Independence Day every Sunday morning. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, first for the independence of our nation and the freedom we enjoy, and also for that wonderful gift that you have given us in freeing us from the burden of sin. We thank you for giving us the opportunity to not only have that freedom, but the responsibility as well. And now we ask that you fill us with courage and wisdom, that we may do what you ask of us, that we may live with the consequences of our actions, good and bad, that we may understand what you have in store for us and for your church. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we normally take our offering, and as I've mentioned, every week since we began gathering again, the plates are in the pews at the front and back of the sanctuary. And I still want to thank and encourage everyone who is watching us on the internet to continue offering your support to the church, whether it's this congregation or First Church in Irvine or whatever church you're a member of. I thank you for your continued support of God's mission. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gifts that you provide to us each and every day. And to show you our gratitude, we offer you the first fruits of our labor for the work of the church. We ask that you accept these gifts along with our time and our talent and our very beings as we become living sacrifices of your will, doing that which you would have us do as disciples of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for this opportunity and ask for your blessings now and always, in Jesus' holy name. Amen. As God were able to please rise for our final hymn, number 610.